Integral to the doctrine of the Holy Spirit within Adventism is the concept of the latter rain, the loud cry, but something that we sometimes fail to connect with these is the fall of Babylon. Ellen White especially dwelt upon these concepts in her writings. Writing about the shaking, she said, "I heard those clothed with the armor speak forth the truth with great power. It had effect. Many had been bound, some wives, husbands, and some children by their parents. The honest who had been prevented from hearing the truth now eagerly laid hold upon it. All fear of their relatives was gone, and the truth alone was exalted to them." And then she continues, "They had been hungering and thirsting for truth. It was dearer and more precious than life. I asked what had made this great change. An angel answered, 'It is the latter rain, the refreshing from the presence of the Lord, the loud cry of the third angel.'" And this early writings, page 271. Then writing at the time just before, or writing about the time just before probation closes, she penned these words, "At that time, the latter rain, or refreshing from the presence of the Lord, will come to give power to the loud cry of the third angel and prepare the saints to stand in the period when the seven last plagues shall be poured out." And so she's saying that the latter rain gives the message and power for the loud cry to go forth. Now, where does this loud cry concept come from? Why do we sometimes in Adventism have this unique idea of this loud cry? If you study through other theologies, if you go into especially Pentecostal theology, you'll find the concept of the latter rain being taught a lot. They believe in something called the latter rain. Okay, but this loud cry idea, it's pretty much an Adventist kind of idea. And I want to show you why. In Revelation chapter 14, 7, the angel says with a what? Loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come, and worship Him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water." Now today I have some of the text, maybe all the text on the screen, because again, we're trying to streamline the time that we have here today. So just be patient with me, but check all these out in your Bible, anything you'd like to check out in your Bible, and I encourage you to be like Brother Mike here and get into the Bible, maybe even get a new Bible and do that if you need one. In verse 8, the second angel's message, "And there followed another angel saying, 'Babylon is fallen, a great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication.'" And then in verse 9, it says that the third angel followed them saying with a what? Loud voice, "If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead and his hand," and he goes on to say that they shall drink of the wine of the wrath of the fornication and so on. But notice that we have this expression in verse 7. There's a loud voice, and we have this loud voice here, again, brought up. Now, there's someplace else that a loud voice or a strong voice is mentioned in Revelation. Do you remember where it is? Well, let's turn to Revelation chapter 18. "And after these things..." The fourth angel's message. "And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried," how? "Mightily with a strong voice, saying, 'Babylon the great is fallen, has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird.'" And verses 3 and 4, he says, "For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, 'Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues.'" Here again, in this angel's message, we now find strong voice. But it's interesting that if you look in the Greek, in both Revelation 14 and Revelation 18, the expressions loud voice and strong voice are the same in the Greek, megaphone, or great voice. And from this we have the English word megaphone, to make a loud noise or a loud voice. And so these loud cries will be empowered by the latter rain coming upon God's people. Now, within the context of Scripture, the rationale for the latter rain and the loud cry is the fall of Babylon. These concepts cannot be separated, because there is a need to warn all, both in Revelation 14, verse 8, in the second angel's message, and here in Revelation chapter 18, verses 1 through 4, there's a need to warn people about Babylon, that Babylon has fallen and has become a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. It's a place where devils live. What they call Halloween. We see advertised haunted houses. You ever hear about that or see that? Or sometimes someone will say, well, a certain house is supposed to be haunted because maybe someone died or was murdered in that house, and maybe their ghost or spirit, they think, hangs out in that house and it scares people or causes little disturbances to happen. And of course, we realize that's all hogwash, right? But the fact is, friends, that there are real demons. And spiritualism is a real thing. And I want to ask you a question. Think about this now. If I told you that in a particular house, there was a demon living in that house, one of the agents of Satan, or maybe even Satan himself, would you live in that house? I dare say you probably wouldn't even set foot for 1 minute in that house, would you? Would you? No. But what about what the angel is saying? He's talking about These churches, that they are a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Friends, we need to be very careful. We don't want to keep company with demons. The message of the fourth angel joins the third angel, and we are told that it swells into a loud cry. In volume 6 of the Testimonies, on page 401, it says, when the storm of persecution really breaks upon us, the true sheep will hear the true shepherd's voice. Let me just stop there for a minute. They hear the true shepherd's voice. You know, she just could have said the shepherd's voice, right? But she added this little adjective here, the true shepherd's voice. Do you know why? Because there's a false shepherd. There's false shepherds. And people have been hearing their voices. Their voices are going out. Lo, I am Christ. I have the truth. I have a message of great light. We'll see that in a little bit. She continues, self-denying efforts will be put forth to save the lost, and many who have strayed from the fold will come back to follow the great shepherd. The people of God will draw together and present to the enemy a united front. And then she says, the love of Christ, the love of our brethren, will testify to the world that we have been with Jesus and learned of Him. Then will the message of the third angel swell to a loud cry, and the whole earth will be lightened with the glory of the Lord. Now, what is this latter rain that the Bible and the Spirit of prophecy speak about? As I mentioned, the concept of a latter rain is not unique to Adventism. And I particularly mentioned the Pentecostal churches. And if you attend the Pentecostal churches today, they're going to tell you, a great many of them, that this latter rain is the Pentecostal revival that began about 120 years ago. And has swept not only America, but basically the world. And that now we have the speaking in tongues, and we have all these manifestations of miracles, and this is the latter rain coming upon us. But I want you to notice that in the Bible, we're going to find that words and spirit are very closely related. The concept of the mind, as defined by Jesus to be spirit, in John 6:63, he says, it is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And words are simply the expression of the thoughts of the mind. In Proverbs chapter 1 and verse 23, he says, turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you. And here in the parallelism, we see spirit and words being synonymous. In Ezekiel chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, "And he said unto me, Son of man, stand upon thy feet, and I will speak unto thee. And the Spirit entered into me when he spake unto me, and set me upon my feet, that I heard him that spake unto me." And here the words that God speaks and his Spirit entering are synonymous. In Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 2, he says, "My doctrine shall drop as the rain, my speech shall distill as the dew, as a small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass." He compares his doctrine, his words, his teachings to what? To rain. To this rain that comes down. Here God's doctrine, his word, comes as the rain or the Spirit. And when God pours out his Spirit, friends, he does it through words and concepts. And this is why Ellen White described the latter rain as greater light. In fact, in Testimonies to Ministers, page 507, she says, "But there must be no neglect of the grace represented by the former rain. Only those who are living up to the light they have will receive greater light." And she's speaking about the former rain, comparing it to light, and only those who've received that will receive what? Greater light. Greater light. And this is one reason why, friends, that we are told the Holy Spirit and the latter rain could be poured out upon people right beside us. We might not notice it. You know, if you're thinking of someone speaking in tongues, jumping up and down, and, you know, maybe even handling snakes or whatever, the idea of that happening and you not noticing seems a little odd. But when truth comes to the heart, someone receives that truth. But how do you know? You may not perceive it. You may not think it's truth at all. You see? Now, there are two special times of rain in the Near East that are mentioned in the Bible. The first is the early rain, which falls from late October to late December. And these rains help the planted seeds to begin to grow and to germinate. Then in March and April come what is termed the latter rain that brings the crops to harvest. Now Joel speaks of both of these in Joel chapter 2 and verse 23. "Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately," former rain or the early rain, moderately, "and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month." You see, around the time of the first month, the latter rain would come, around the time of what we call March or late April. Now here Joel speaks of these two rains together. And I found this comment I thought was very interesting from the New American Commentary on Hosea and Joel, and says this: "Of great interest, however, is whether the phrase 'autumn rains in righteousness' should be translated 'teacher of righteousness.' The Hebrew is ambiguous and could mean either. Some believe that this phrase in Joel, interpreted as 'teacher of righteousness' by the Qumran sectarians, led them to believe that a certain teacher who appeared among them at the very time the Jews were suffering under the Romans was the prophesied teacher of righteousness." Now remember, there was this group of people, and they were in an area called Qumran, and they had written out scrolls, and they had copied the scriptures, and they put them in these urns and things, and they hid them in caves, and those are what we today call the Dead Sea Scrolls.
The Essenes.
And it says here that they understood this text of Joel to be a teacher of righteousness. And indeed, if you have one of those new Cambridge wide margin Bibles, or a standard Cambridge Bible, or most marginal reference Bibles, you will see in the reference to Joel 2:23, "The former rain moderately," or "a teacher of righteousness moderately," Hebrew "according to righteousness," and here I've just made it on this slide a little bigger so it's easier to see. But in other words, when he says this former rain and this latter rain, they're saying the Hebrew is a little ambiguous. It maybe could be translated, "I'm sending you a teacher of righteousness, according to righteousness." Now, the Essenes thought that this teacher of righteousness was coming at about their time. And I ask you a question: was there a teacher of righteousness sent by God at about the time that the Romans were in power.
Yes.
In John chapter 3 and verse 2, Nicodemus said unto Jesus, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. They recognized Jesus to be a teacher from God. And A.T. Jones, we're talking in Sabbath school about the 188 message and righteousness by faith. And of course, that's so closely connected with Wagner and Jones and Adventism. And Jones understood that the giving of the early rain and the latter rain involved the teaching of righteousness, and that it would come from a teacher of righteousness. And during the 1893 General Conference session, he spoke about this. And I'm just going to share some of the things that he said, and I hope it's readable on the screen for you. He says, now calling attention again to a thought that we have studied before, with which to begin this study tonight directly, that is, what this righteousness is to us now. Let us turn back to that passage in Joel, the second chapter and 23rd verse, and notice also the marginal reading. Let me just pause there. Did we read Joel 2:23 earlier? And did we also notice the marginal reading? Jones saw it. He saw it a long time before we did. Notice what he says. He reads the text. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain. And then he continues. And this is Jones speaking at the 1893 General Conference session. And this is all recorded in the bulletin, and this is beginning here on page 243, or 242 rather, on page 242. And this is what Jones says. He says, our study on that was in bulletin number 7, page 183. So he's making reference back to something that they've covered already. It's already been published. He says, what is the margin? He hath given you the former rain. What is that? A teacher of righteousness. Given you the former rain moderately. What is that? Moderately. What was the former rain at Pentecost? A teacher of righteousness. He hath given you a teacher of righteousness according to righteousness. What was the former rain? And he will give you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain as at the first. What will the latter rain be? And then Jones says, a teacher of righteousness again. According to what? And the congregation responds, saying righteousness. But what is another expression for the latter rain? And the congregation says, the outpouring of the Spirit. What is another one? Congregation, the times are refreshing. What is the latter rain to the third angel's message? And the congregation says, the loud cry. What is the latter rain in connection with the fall of Babylon? It is the bestowal of that power and that glory with which the angel of Revelation 18 comes down and lightens the earth. And then Jones continues. Now let's read a few passages of those that we have had already to get the connection here definitely. On page 58 of the bulletin in Brother Haskell's lesson, we had, as it was read from the review of November 22nd, these words. Now, he says we're going to read something that Haskell was making reference to in a study. And what he was making reference to was something that was already printed in the Review and Herald. And notice what it is. The time of test is just upon us. For the loud cry of the third angel has already begun in the revelation of the righteousness of Christ. This is the beginning of the light of the third angel, whose glory shall fill the whole earth. Now that's what Jones was preaching there in 1893, making a reference to something Ellen White had printed in the Review and Herald of November 22, 1892, and we'll look at the reference in a little more detail in just a few minutes. Jones then says, another passage on page 16 of the bulletin, in that testimony that was read, yet the work will be cut short in righteousness. What work will be cut short in righteousness, he asks. The message of Christ's righteousness is to sound from one end of the world to the other. This is the glory of God which closes the work of the third angel. And just a couple more references here from Jones. He says, what is this message of Christ's righteousness as we read here before in these other places? This is the beginning of the light of the third angel whose glory shall fill the whole earth. Now, this is the glory of God which closes the work of the third angel. And then he says, then when we have come to that time, what time have we reached? And the congregation says, the loud cry of the message. We have reached the time when God is going to close it up. That is the glory that closes the work of the message. Now, in one of these earlier paragraphs, Jones quoted from a Review and Herald article written by Ellen White, where she declared that the loud cry of the third angel had already begun in the revelation of the righteousness of Christ. She says, this is the beginning of the light of the third angel whose glory shall fill the whole earth. But before that statement, Ellen White said this, the third angel's message is swelling into a loud cry. In 1892, she says it is swelling into a loud cry. It is our work today to yield our souls to Christ that we may be fitted for the time of refreshing from the presence of the Lord, fitted for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That's what she was saying in March of 1892. Now, what is the background to these events and the happenings in 1892 and then in 1893 there? In 1888, there was a general conference session in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And this had taken place about 4 years prior to these events. And the light from that conference had prepared the people to receive the beginning of the latter rain. The beginning of the loud cry was happening, she says. Because of what Jones and Wagner preached and these concepts that were being amplified in the church and being spread, this was it. Now, I want to talk about this Minneapolis conference for just a minute because we only get a portion of the history of this conference. Most people do not get the overall picture. We only have one focus, and that was the focus that Jones and Wagner spoke simply about justification, or even expanding it to righteousness by faith, a little further beyond that. And when most people think about the 1888 conference, they think simply of righteousness by faith as being the issue of that conference. But that is only partly true, at least as it relates to the individual's relationship to God. Because righteousness by faith involves more than just our individual relationship to God. The 1888 message, as given by Jones and Wagner, reached the entire sphere of humanity. It certainly dealt with righteousness by faith and how the individual relates to and comes into harmony with God, but there are two other very important and distinct components of that message. Another area that Jones and Wagner expounded extensively upon was church organization, or how the individual relates to the body of believers. The third area covered was religious liberty, or how the individual, as well as the body of the church, relates to the civil authorities. And the diversity of these three areas can be seen in a list of studies that A.T. Jones gave shortly after the 1888 conference in 1889 at the Ottawa, Kansas camp meeting. A.T. Jones spoke on religious liberty 14 times. He spoke on church organization 11 times. But he only spoke on messages of justification by faith 6 times. Isn't that something? So Jones was speaking here. You can add it up. 31 times. That was a lot of speaking, wasn't it? Probably no problem for Jones. He was such an encyclopedia of information. You could just get up and start talking, it would just flow out. But you can see that there was an emphasis here that we don't hear today a lot about and don't see as much about. Now, while there was no minutes preserved from the Minneapolis conference, we know certain things about it based upon history. For instance, we know that Wagner spoke certain points about Christ our righteousness because his wife kept notes of his talks, and those notes were later put in the book Christ our righteousness, sometimes published under the name Christ and his righteousness or the righteousness of Christ. But Jones says this also. We know that Jones spoke a great deal on religious liberty because in his preface to the book, Civil Government and Religion, one of A.T. Jones' book, in the preface, he says this, this little work is the outgrowth of several lectures upon the relationship between religion and the civil power delivered in Minneapolis, Minnesota in October 1888. So in the preface to this book, he says, this is the outgrowth of several lectures I gave at the 1888 conference. Jones notes that he gave several lectures. And what was happening at this time that would have stirred an interest in the relation of religion and civil powers? In May 21st of 1888, Senator Henry William Blair, the sophomore Republican senator from New Hampshire, proposed Senate Bill 2983 with the following intention: to secure to the people the enjoyment of the first day of the week, commonly known as the Lord's Day, as a day of rest, and to promote its observance as a day of worship. In other words, it was a national Sunday law bill. This bill was fought by H.E. Jones and was later defeated. And in December the 13th of 1888, Jones appeared on the United States Senate floor to speak against this bill. So you had the Minneapolis conference, he's speaking about civil governments and religion, and then the next month or so, he is here in the United States Senate, and he says this, and in fact, he said a lot. There's a whole book published on all that he said. At first, they were going to give him an hour, but when you read it, you realize that it took several hours, but they listened. Jones said, "We object to the whole principle of the proposed legislation. We go to the root of the matter and deny the right of Congress to enact it." Jones understood that might was not right. One of our brethren from Oakwood College wrote a paper called "The Blair Sunday Bill of 1888, Religious Reform or Social Engineering, Seneca Vaughn," and I believe he's a teacher at Kennesaw State College right now. But in that paper, he stated this: "Senator Harry Blair and the bulk of his supporters based the thrust of their movement on the premise that the majority was the decisive factor in what was ultimately good and desirable for American society." Do we hear that same thing today? It's what's good for the majority. And that's what determines what is good. But might is not right. And so this is some of the backdrop to the time of 1888-1892. And Ellen White said that in November 22, 1892, that the loud cry of the third angel was already going forth. But then, 3 weeks after that testimony about the loud cry going forth, she published something else in the Review. And it's dated back to the very day that Jones stood on the Senate floor. And that date is December 13, 1892 now. December 13, in other words, 4 years after he was there. She says this. Notice this in the context of everything. "After the truth has been proclaimed as a witness to all nations, every conceivable power of evil will be set in operation, and minds will be confused by many voices crying, 'Lo, here is Christ. Lo, he is there. This is the truth. I have the message from God. He has sent me with great light.'" Let me just stop. Remember she said earlier that the people would listen to the true shepherd's voice? Because there have been many voices. I have a great message from God. And she says, "This happens after the truth has been proclaimed as a witness to all nations." And notice what she says happens next. "Then." What does the word "then" mean? You tell me. I don't want to...
Next to follow.
Next to follow. After something just before, right? Mm-hmm. What was just before? After the truth has been proclaimed as a witness to the world, after all these people got and said, "I've got great light, I have a message from God." "Then there will be a removing of the landmarks and an attempt to tear down the pillars of our faith." Then there will be a removing of the landmarks and an attempt to tear down the pillars of our faith. She says, "A more decided effort will be made to exalt the false Sabbath and to cast contempt upon God Himself by supplanting the day He has blessed and sanctified. This false Sabbath is to be enforced by an impressive law." And then she says, "Satan and his angels are wide awake and intensely active, working with energy and perseverance through human instrumentalities to bring about his purpose of obliterating from the minds of men the knowledge of God." Not just simply the day that he worships on, but the knowledge of God. Would a false understanding of God help meet those purposes? And then she says, but while Satan works with his lying wonders, the time will be fulfilled, foretold in the Revelation, and the mighty angel that shall lighten the earth with his glory will proclaim the fall of Babylon and call upon God's people to forsake her. Now the concepts of the latter rain, the loud cry, and the fall of Babylon are hand in glove. Isn't that right? And she's speaking here about an outpouring of the latter rain. She's speaking about a time when there's going to be an attempt to tear down the pillars of our faith. In fact, she says that the landmarks will be removed. And then she says, after this time, and in connection with it, there's a message to proclaim the fall of Babylon and for God's people to forsake her. In other words, friends, if there was ever a time to say, if a church is part of Babylon, to come out of that church. Right now. In 1892, the Lord was moving upon his people. The political stage was being set, but something happened that stopped the process. And it should be obvious that the loud cry does not need 120 years to finish the work. But why was it cut off? Now, at the inauguration of President Donald Trump, Franklin Graham gave one of the invocations, and in that, he said this, Mr. President, in the Bible, rain is a sign of God's blessing. Of course, at the time that Mr. Trump started to speak, it began to rain. But Franklin Graham is right in this sense that rain is a sign of God's blessing, of his Holy Spirit being poured out. That is true. But what would then withhold the rain? What would withholding rain represent? The displeasure of God. And notice what God told Israel through Jeremiah. In Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 3, therefore the showers have been withholden, and there hath been no latter rain, and thou hast a whore's forehead. Thou refusest to be ashamed. I did a lot of things when I was younger I wasn't too proud of, and sometimes when I got caught I was pretty ashamed. But they're caught and they're not even ashamed. They went whoring after other gods because you know that biblically, to play the harlot, biblically, spiritually, means to go after other gods. And they're not ashamed of it. They don't apologize for it. And they're proud of it. We are clearly told, though, no outward shrines may be visible. There may be no image for the eye to rest upon, yet we may be practicing idolatry. How could we do that? She says, it is as easy to make an idol of cherished ideas or objects as to fashion gods of wood or stone. Thousands have a false conception of God and his attributes. And then she says, they are as verily serving a false god as were the servants of Baal. Are we worshiping the true God as he is revealed in his word, in Christ, in nature, or are we adorning some philosophical idol enshrined in his place? And I'd like to say today, yes, that many people are in the form of a doctrine called the Trinity. It is a false doctrine about God. It is a philosophical argument about who God is. And she says that when we have that idea, when we worship that idea, we are worshiping a false god as much as the children of Israel were worshiping a false god when they were bowing down to Baal. And when you play the spiritual harlot, God withholds the rain. It's just that simple. Now, the doctrine of the Trinity entered into our church, this doctrine of a false god, and while it didn't happen in 1888, the seeds were beginning to be sown shortly thereafter. Not only the seeds for the doctrine of the Trinity, but the seeds for the doctrine that would allow us to accept the Trinity. The call in Revelation 18 is to come out of Babylon. But again, what is Babylon? The name Babylon, you know, rightly means what? It comes from Babel, it means confusion. And we are told in the Great Controversy on page 381, in Revelation 14, the first angel is followed by a second proclaiming, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, Revelation 14:8. The term Babylon is derived from Babel and signifies confusion. It is employed in Scripture to designate the various forms of false or apostate religion. In Revelation 17, Babylon is represented as a woman, a figure which is used in the Bible as a symbol of a church. A virtuous woman represents a pure church, a vile woman, an apostate church. And then she says, the great sin charged against Babylon is that she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. This cup of intoxication which she presents to the world represents the false doctrines that she has accepted as the result of her unlawful connection with the great ones of the earth. Friendship with the world corrupts her faith, and in turn she exerts a corrupting influence upon the world by teaching doctrines which are opposed to the plainest statements of Holy Writ. And I don't think you'll find a statement more opposing Holy Writ than the doctrine of the Trinity. She continues, on page 382, it was by departure from the Lord and an alliance with the heathen that the Jewish church became a harlot. Rome, corrupting herself in like manner by seeking the support of worldly powers, receives a like condemnation. But she doesn't finish here. She doesn't end here. She says Babylon is said to be the mother of harlots. By her daughters must be symbolized churches that cling to her doctrines and traditions and follow her example of sacrificing the truth and the approval of God in order to form an unlawful alliance with the world. Now I want you to consider these points. Consider what she said, and we must honestly ask and then try to answer the following questions. Could a church that teaches as its central doctrine the foundational doctrine of the beast, the foundational doctrine of the papacy, be Christian or remnant? Or does it become part of one of her daughters who clings to those teachings? Revelation 17:2 says that the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Wine in the Bible is a symbol of false doctrine, and the churches as well as the world is drunk today. Now, I'm not proud to tell you, but when I was in a younger and foolisher age, I used to drink alcohol. And I drank it sometimes to the excess that I became what you would call drunk. Not just simply legally drunk, but I was drunk. But I know one thing about drinking, and that is that the only way that you ever become sober is to quit drinking. You get on a drunk. I had an uncle who was a severe alcoholic, and he would get on a drunk and he would stay drunk for weeks at a time because he would just continually drink. He would never have a chance to get sober. And as long as you are imbibing in alcohol, you never get sober. But here we're talking about spiritual wine, spiritual alcohol, these false doctrines, and as long as you keep imbibing in them, friends, you're never going to get sober spiritually. It won't happen. Could a church that uses the power of the state to persecute church members be the remnant? When A.T. Jones was speaking before the United States Senate in 1888 against the Blair Bill, the issue of exemptions came up. The Seventh-day Baptist Church was there, and they were agreeable to allow the National Sunday Law Bill to take effect if an exemption could be made for their church. A.T. Jones strongly objected. Jones stated that if, for example, someone wanted to open a saloon on Sunday, they could simply state that they were Seventh-day Baptists and get an exemption. To this, A.H. Lewis of the Baptist stated that no Seventh-day Baptist church would allow any such person as a member, and from what he knew of the Seventh-day Adventists, that no Seventh-day Adventists would sanction such a member either. Therefore, he said the objection of Jones could not find an application. But I want you to notice, and I want you to notice carefully what Jones said in relationship to what the Baptists had said. He said, Mr. Chairman, it is certainly true that, so far, a saloon-keeping Seventh-day Baptist or Seventh-day Adventist either is an unknown thing. But if Sunday laws are enforced with an exemption clause in favor of those who keep the seventh day, this would not be an unknown thing much longer. It is true also that such a man could not obtain membership in any Seventh-day Baptist or Seventh-day Adventist church, but what is to prevent the saloon keepers from organizing Seventh-day Baptist or Seventh-day Adventist churches of their own and for themselves? He says, what is to prevent them or any class of businessmen from organizing their own churches, electing their own officers, and even ordaining their own pastors, calling themselves Seventh-day Baptist or Seventh-day Adventist? And Jones insightfully, prophetically stated then, there is nothing to prevent it unless, indeed, the state itself shall take charge of all Seventh-day Adventist churches and doctrines and attend to their organization and the admission of members. Oh, you mean the state's going to determine who can be called a Seventh-day Adventist? And Jones knew that this was wicked many years ago. If Jones were alive today and could see the way the professed people of God try to, quote, protect their good name, unquote, by having the civil governments enforce their trademark laws, he would be appalled and denounce it in the strongest terms, saying that it is indeed an unlawful alliance with the world that has been made. I ask you also, could a church that denies the work of Jesus to fully cleanse his people from sin, a church that declares salvation was all purchased on the cross and atonement was finished there, and Christ obtains nothing for us in heaven today, could that be God's church today? Could it be the remnant today? No, friends, not at all. We are past the time when the landmarks and the pillars have been removed. And she says that after that time, we are to give a message to call the people in these fallen churches to come out of Babylon. Remember that the 1888 message was about more than justification. It involved the whole sphere of humanity, including church organization and how men deal with men. And part of the merchandise of Revelation 18 or of Babylon, part of the merchandise of Babylon that's mentioned in Revelation 18 in verse 13 is the souls of men. At the very heart of Romanism is the control of men over men. And in connection with the fall of Babylon, there must be a message that denounces that which helps to make Babylon, Babylon. I want you to notice the following very carefully from testimonies to ministers and gospel workers. She says, God has given to men talents of influence which belong to him alone, and no greater dishonor can be done to God than for one finite agent to bring other men's talents under his absolute control, even though the benefits of the same be used to the advantage of the cause. In other words, she says, you can't use the wrong things even if it supposedly is right. And then she says, in such arrangements, one man's mind is ruled by another man's mind, and the human agency is separated from God and exposed to temptation. Satan's methods tend to one end, to make men slaves of men. Page 362, she says, the goodness, mercy, and love of God were proclaimed by Christ to Moses. This was God's character. When men who profess to serve God ignore his parental character and depart from honor and righteousness in dealing with their fellow men, Satan exalts, for he has inspired them with his attributes. They are following in the track of Romanism. When we set up a situation where men are ruling over men, we're following in the track of Romanism. And when we ignore God's parental character, you know what Ellen White says? She says it's a favorite theme of Jesus was the parental nature of God. But of course, we teach today that God's not even a father at all, is he? He only takes the title or the role of a father. He's not even a father at all in the doctrine of the Trinity. On page 363, she brings this out. She says, the righteousness of Christ by faith has been ignored by some, for it is contrary to their spirit and their whole life experience. Rule has been their course of action. Now, friends, that's not saying anything about faith. It's not saying anything about forgiveness of sins. It's not saying anything about the common things we commonly think of when we talk about the 18:8 message or righteousness by faith. But she says that the righteousness of Christ by faith has been ignored because, and here's the evidence, they have the spirit of rule, and they're following in the track of Romanism. Ellen White wrote these things from Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers in 1895. What would she say if she was alive today? Now, if one looks into a field and they see an animal that looks like a cow, it eats grass like a cow, it moves like a cow, gives milk like a cow, what do you think it is? It's a cow. But if we see a church, no matter what the profession is, no matter what the name is, but we see a church that teaches the doctrines of God like Babylon, the doctrine of God like Babylon, if we see a church that persecutes using the civil authorities like Babylon, that rules over its members like Babylon, friends, it may not be Babylon the Great, but it is one of the daughters for sure. Because Babylon has daughters. And those daughters, we are told, symbolize churches that cling to her doctrines and traditions and follow her example of sacrificing the truth and the approval of God in order to form an unlawful alliance with the world. We read that earlier in Great Controversy, page 382 and 383. Now, how are people going to react? If you hear a message clarifying righteousness by faith, and people hear a message that includes coming out of Babylon, how are they going to react to that? Well, Ellen White was writing, and she was in Europe, in Norway, in 1885. And she was speaking about some people that weren't helping in the work and how they might react to certain things. And so I thought this was interesting because this gives us an idea of what might just be coming up. She says, unless those who can help in, and she doesn't say the area, and it's not on the website either. They didn't include it in the thing. But she says, unless those who can help in such an area are aroused to a sense of their duty, they will not recognize the work of the Lord when the loud cry of the third angel shall be heard. So she says there's going to be some people that when the loud cry of the third angel goes forth, they're not going to be able to recognize it because they haven't been in step with God in His work. She says, when light goes forth to lighten the earth, instead of coming up to the help of the Lord, they will want to bind about His work to meet their narrow ideas. Let me tell you that the Lord will work in this last work in a manner very much out of the common order of things and in a way that will be contrary to any human planning. There will be those among us who will always want to control the work of God, to dictate even what movements shall be made when the work goes forward under the direction of the angel who joins the third angel in the message to be given to the world. God will use ways and means by which it will be seen He is taking the reins in His own hands. I think that what we're going to see happen, friends, very clearly is people aren't going to understand, they're not going to perceive, and they're going to try to bind the work, they're going to try to stop it. They have their own ideas how things have to be. Now, you probably have heard it said that in the testimonies, it says that we're not to call the church Babylon. And we gave a message recently, does God change? And if you've not heard that message yet, you need to go back, or you need to hear that message first. It will help you on this. But in that message, we discussed this in detail about what Ellen White said when she said, never call the church Babylon. But in that study, we saw the importance of studying the testimonies in relationship to time and place where they were given. In Selected Messages, Book 1, page 57, we saw the quotation there. And the real issue today, though, is not what Ellen White wrote, for example, about the General Conference in 1901, when she said this. In 1901, Ellen White wrote about the General Conference. She said that these men should stand in sacred place to be as the voice of God to the people, as we once believed the General Conference to be. That is past. She said that in 1901. We might say that the issue is not what she said in 1909. In 1909, she said this. At times when a small group of men entrusted with the general management of the work have, in the name of the General Conference, sought to carry out unwise plans and to restrict God's work, I have said that I could no longer regard the voice of the General Conference represented by these few men as the voice of God. But, there's that little word but. But this is not saying that the decisions of the General Conference, composed of an assembly of duly appointed representative men from all parts of the field, should not be respected. God has ordained that the representatives of His church from all parts of the earth, when assembled in a General Conference, shall have authority. In 1901, she said, General Conference isn't the voice of God anymore. I don't believe that. And she must have said it more than one time, because she makes reference that at times, she says, at times I've said this, even though you only have the one statement in print. But now she says in 1909, General Conference has authority. Well, which one do you believe? You see. In other words, you have to take time and place and the context of what's being said into consideration, right? And so the important thing, the real issue for us now, is what God says today about us and the message we proclaim and the lives that we live. And I'm just going to give you a little footnote here that we should note that when Ellen White wrote these words that we just read in 1909, she was vouching for a duly appointed representative General Conference. She said that it was to be respected and considered as the voice of God. Now we need to put into our thinking cap that the rules for assembling a General Conference in 1980 were the same basic rules that were put in place in 1909. You say, why is that important? Because in 1980, a duly called conference was assembled at Dallas, Texas, where a new fundamental set of beliefs was voted that included the doctrine of the Trinity, a finished atonement, and it deleted our view on the papacy as being the man of sin, and that the papacy was foretold in prophecy to mislead almost all Christendom in regard to the fourth commandment. That was totally deleted. The Trinity was brought in. The finished atonement was brought in at the cross. And it was all done by a duly appointed General Conference. And so what I'm telling you is this, friends. We have to make a decision. We have to come to understand something. If that was still God's church, even in 1980, that's been 37 years ago. That's hard to believe, isn't it? Then we need to bow down before the doctrine of the Trinity and tell God we were wrong. We need to tell God that we were wrong forever misunderstanding and interpreting and teaching wrong against Him, because that was the voice of God. But friends, if it was error, then the General Conference could no longer be the voice of God, even though it was a duly called group. Again, the real issue for us now is what God says today about us, the message we proclaim, and the life that we live. Are we, as a class, with those that she writes about in Acts of the Apostles on page 11, when she says, from the beginning, faithful souls have constituted the church on earth. Are we part of those faithful souls? Are we those people who are crying out about these doctrinal abuses, crying out about these civil government abuses, crying out about other abuses? Are we part of the faithful souls? We may not be a member of a great cathedral. We may not be part of a national establishment or even one of the various denominations, but are we the people who love God and keep His commandments? Ellen White says that where two or three are gathered together in My name, there am I in the midst of them, actually quoting from Jesus in Matthew 18:20. Where Christ is even among the humble few, this is Christ's church, for the presence of the High and Holy One who inhabits the eternity can alone constitute a church. And so friends, if I'm involved in part of Babylon, and I'm told I have to come out of Babylon, Christ isn't there, because where Christ is, that's where His church is. But these aren't Christ's church anymore. Ellen White, well, let me ask you a question. Do you believe the mark of the beast is soon to happen? Amen. We are told the mark of the beast is soon to be urged upon us, beloved. Are we ready for that time? We're told in volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 215, the seal of God will never be placed upon the forehead of an impure man or woman. It will never be placed upon the forehead of the ambitious, word-loving man or woman. It will never be placed upon the forehead of men or women of false tongues or deceitful hearts. All who receive the seal must be without spot before God, candidates for heaven. And you can't accept this as truth. You can't accept and have the seal of God if you believe in the theology of sin and repent till Jesus comes. Because it says they're without spot and blemish. To those who hear these words and maybe think, well, I'm better than these apostates who compromise the truth. I will always teach the truth. Please consider what the following testimony says in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 213. Not all who profess to keep the Sabbath will be sealed. There are many, even among those who teach the truth to others, who will not receive the seal of God in their foreheads. And let me just pause here. This was long before the doctrine of the Trinity ever came to the church. She says, they had the light of truth. They knew their master's will. They understood every point of our faith. In other words, they weren't misunderstanding. But they had not corresponding what?
Works.
Oh, wait a minute. I thought works had nothing to do with our salvation, our eternal redemption. These people knew it. They understood it. It was clear. But she says they did not have corresponding works. And then she continues. She says, these who were so familiar with prophecy and treasures of divine wisdom should have acted their faith. They should have commanded their households after them that by a well-ordered family they might present to the world the influence of the truth upon the human heart. She says, not one of us will ever receive the seal of God while our characters have one spot or stain upon them. It is left with us to remedy the defects in our characters, to cleanse the soul temple from every defilement. Then the latter rain will fall upon us as the early rain fell upon the disciples on the day of Pentecost. Volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 214. Zechariah chapter 10 and verse 1. Zechariah says, ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. So the Lord shall make bright showers and give them showers of rain to every one grass in the field. He says that we should be asking for the latter rain. To ask for the latter rain. We are to ask, beloved, but it is in vain to ask if we do not bring our lives in line with God's word so that our characters may be fitted for heaven. Our thoughts produce actions, and our actions produce habits, and by our habits, our characters are formed, and characters determine our eternity and our destiny. James, in closing, says, be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. It says, behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and latter rain. Be ye also patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.